FAM Aslan Shah Cup 2017. Live on Astro Arena and HD.
Watch La La Land free exclusively on demand for all Astro customers now on connected PVR and Astro Go.
Playoffs, it's a whole new season for us.
It's a special thing.
Worked all season long.
The real season starts now.
The NBA playoffs on Astro Supersport 4 and Astro Go.
The sun shines bright in Las Colinas Country Club with an annual gathering for the greater good. Here, the focus is not on winning alone, but in getting people back on their feet.
Fabulous week for Jenny Shin.
And there's no better reason to celebrate in that. The Volunteers of America Texas Shootout on Golf Channel.
This program is brought to you by Wanda Coffee. Tastes like just brewed.
Hello and welcome back to the show right here on Astro Supersport. It is Football Countdown, joined by the usual suspects and a new person as well. Not really new, but he's back on the set. The one and only Des Corkhill, a.k.a. Deadly Des, is on my right. Steve McMahon and Statsman Stan with me in the studio. Gentlemen, remember, thank you for being on the show. Let's be nice. And if you're not nice, whoop-de-doo. But this is your show, so do get in touch with us via our Twitter account. That's at Stadium Astro. And the first Twitter question comes from Hanif, who says, will Chelsea's talented youth thrive under Antonio Conte and finally be given the chance in the senior squad? Steve, since you've played at the highest level of football, yes or no?
Well, you've won it for the past 6 years or so now. So nothing's come through as such, because the demand for success very quickly at Chelsea is so high. So the managers can't take a chance on youngsters. So maybe they go out on loan for a couple of years and come back, or they get sold on. So it's a difficult question to answer when you have to pin all the hopes on actually winning today, not thinking about tomorrow.
I think the key with youngsters is you need a really special talent. You can have 11 winning for 6 years consecutively, and you'll probably see one of those talents regularly starting to get, not first 11, but starting to get 20 minutes, 30 minutes. And then when he's given that time, he needs to prove himself, because that's how tough it is at this point. Because managers get sacked within 4 or 5 games if the results are not right at a club like Chelsea.
This Steven Gerrard comment about the lack of physicality, how they're not actually preparing at youth level to play in the Premier League. I think that's the best comment that I've heard from Steven Gerrard, and they've been great, some great comments from him. They're not being prepared, they're not being trained to play at the very top level. That's why they're not succeeding. Well, because the competition is under 21 level. It's not like the old reserve team football, which used to go out and get playing against men. Agreed. You're playing against in the 23s.
Plus the fact that you've got to be a club that puts you into the first team. Everton, Southampton have proven over a period of time that they will put players in. They will make sure to get a chance. You look at the size, and I'm not the Chelsea youth squad,
the
Manchester City, because City have been there for the past 3 years as well. So the City, Chelsea have got a monopoly on the FA Youth Cup.
But it's Everton who just won the Premier League youth title. Everton have just won that under 23 title.
Well, because there's a lot of games.
But the other problem with, I mean, good point that you bring up, Steven Gerrard did say about being obsessed on being the best when he was a kid. And every day you go into training being wanting to be the best. But that's a problem right now there, because even at this level, the boys are already earning money, which usually top professionals back in the day after 5 years of probably playing top level with top clubs. So that's where another problem comes in.
I'd like to think money wasn't involved in this, especially at this age. You want to get into a first team, you want to play.
But it is now.
Well, maybe, but I'd like to think it isn't.
All right, gentlemen, we have to move forward. I think that's a fantastic talking point, which we can save for another day. The next question is directed to our special guest here today. It is from Arvind, who says, to Dez, Liverpool losing to Palace was a big, big setback. Do you think they can make top four, or will that result alone come back to haunt them?
Statistically, Liverpool are the fifth best highest paid team in the league. So statistically, they should be fifth best. They've overachieved massively in the first part of the year. They've got huge injury problems to deal with. The results say that if they win all four, they will make the Champions League. If they do, credit to them. But United
will
are on
they?
The tail.
Point is, will they?
Yes, I think they will.
Okay. You've got two Liverpool boys here. Of course, they're going to say yes. Stan, yes or no? Quick
United
one.
United in top four.
So Liverpool, no.
Yeah, Man City will make it with United, Spurs and Chelsea. Yep, I've said
so
that.
Simply put, Liverpool, no. You just went the wrong
way
around.
We just said no, Liverpool, just no.
All right.
So, I don't see any reason, any rationale in that. Because Des just said, and it's fact, that Liverpool win four games, regardless of the other... all the permutations says Liverpool will be fourth at least. So Liverpool should qualify for Champions League with four games to go.
Against the odds.
All right, gentlemen.
It's not against the odds. They don't have to win four games.
No, I'm saying United against the odds.
This is what I have to put up with every week. But moving on swiftly over to Arsene Wenger. Here he is.
I expect an open match, committed match, a match with high pace. But there could be goals in there because both teams play a positive football and try to go forward and play in an offensive way. So normally that finishes with goals if you look at the quality of the players on both sides. I'm not in a position today where the sentiment comes in too much, but as you said, your colleague told me that I played the 50s London Derby, so of course there were some intense, some special ones in there. I don't think I'm not especially in a mode today to reflect on that. Maybe one day, yes, I will write a book just about the derbies. Let's be honest, I answered that question of shift 18 consecutive years. So. So that nothing changes in that.
I wonder if his book will be called My Way or The Highway. Got the North London Derby coming up this weekend. I mean, we also got Everton-Chelsea, but this is massive in terms of that push for the top four we were talking about.
His book should be called Should I Stay or Should I Go Now?
Yeah. I said, good song.
Good song. There's a song in there somewhere. 18 years he's been saying it, maybe, because they have dominated Tottenham for that period of time. Is it a changing of the guards? Possibly. Tottenham have got it right. The new stadium helps, like it did with Arsenal, remember that?
Yeah.
At the old Highbury. So it does help. Tottenham are very, very good, and you can see them lasting another 10 years with the manager, with the players, with the development programme, the infrastructure. Why can't Tottenham overtake Arsenal in their rebuilding process?
Well, besides the fact that they've improved from last season, they're a better side this season, I would say. They're more stronger. They walk into this game with six wins on a trot. That shows a very, very settled 11. Pochettino gets the best out of them walking into this game. I know it's a derby. Many will say just take the form guide, throw out the window. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't. For me, Spurs are walking into this game as the favourites, massive favourites.
As for Pochettino, and the question being, is there a shift change? I think under Pochettino, there's a shift change, because of him. If he leaves, there's a problem for Tottenham, because he is such a good cultural fit.
But did you
think he's bringing up players? They didn't spend money in the summer, and he's bringing young players. I don't know who could replace Pochettino. As for Wenger, he's not really going to go anywhere.
But is the problem with the fact that Pochettino leaves, these stars leave as well? Or is the fact that someone else take over this same team? Look, he's got a bit of luck on his side, even though I know he's a very good manager. There's a very good bunch of youngsters that have come through. And you do get this luck at times.
But he has made them. He has brought these players through.
Yeah, so I'm just saying, if someone else...
He did actually spend money in a summer. He spent a lot of money.
On Sissoko, who's been a bit
And what about Janssen? There's 50 million.
And Janssen as well. But he didn't spend any... Sorry, the old net spend argument. It was very, very little.
Well, he's still judged on his signings. You could say that about Klopp.
But where I'm going with this is, I think it's Pochettino's team. And he leaves and there's a problem.
So you're saying the fact that it's such a good side at this point, they're playing fantastically well as a team, and he leaves and the same squad remains without them losing any of the stars. Do you think another manager would not take them further? You've seen
how players can react to different managers. You've just seen it with Leicester City this year. You've seen it with Mourinho.
But they won it. Last season under Ranieri, that doesn't show anything. And this season, players change.
Players can change their loyalties. But if Pochettino goes to Barcelona, which is a possibility, if he goes somewhere else, you see, this is a coach in demand. He could well leave Tottenham because it could well be perceived that Tottenham is a stepping stone. For Arsene Wenger, this is where Arsene Wenger belongs. This is where he stays.
Steve, can they survive without Mauricio Pochettino?
Well, the club is always bigger than any individual. That has always been the same. What he's done
at the club, he's built it, like Deza said, he's brought in the young players. If you compare it to the likes of Wenger, Jose Mourinho, Pep's first year, but the progress Tottenham have made under him.
He's laid the foundations, and he's growing with Tottenham. He's grown as a coach, and the players are growing with him. The development of Tottenham is growing alongside the rest of them.
Well, so did Wenger in his early years. I mean, if you're comparing Pochettino's reign at Spurs and Wenger's reign since 1997 and his early
start. But Wenger didn't go anywhere. Pochettino could. That's the point I'm making.
Wenger should go somewhere.
I'm a big Arsene fan. He's allowed a dodgy season. Of course he is. He'll just need to stop himself.
How many dodgy seasons?
What? He's been Champions League. Hang on one sec there.
You just said he needs a strong centre-half. You were on the show...
No, centre midfielder. He needs Granit Xhaka. He needs Granit Xhaka to be the player I thought Granit Xhaka was going to be.
Well, he won't be that player. Anyway, you said he was crying out for a centre-half and he had him.
And he had Mustafi. Yes.
Yeah, what's happened?
Mustafi's let him down.
So Xhaka's let you down, he's let Mustafi down, he's let the Arsenal fans down.
It's the manager's problem at this point.
Positives over negatives. Yeah. We've already spoken about Arsene Wenger and what's going on with Arsenal. Hope something changes for your sake. You want him to say, but in terms of what we've seen, we've always had this scenario, and we have a lot of Arsenal fans in the studio as well. When I say the crew, they'll always laugh at Tottenham. They've always made fun of them. But do you see that shift every weekend? Every weekend when we've been covering the Premier League, don't you see Tottenham heading in the right direction and Arsenal going in the wrong way?
Yes, I do. Over the past two seasons, you could see the writing on a wall somewhat. Yeah. Absolutely, 100%. And the Arsenal supporters you're talking about, our crew that we see week in, week out, they're not happy at all. And they feel the way I do as a supporter, that Arsene Wenger should go.
But last season, having said that, even though and you would say large parts of the season Spurs were looking good, at the end of the day, Arsenal finished second.
Yeah, because they bottled it. They weren't in a position.
The DNA of the club. Because years before, they sit in top four. And all of a sudden they sit fifth or sixth by the end of the season. And that's what happened last season as well. So it's very important this season, Pochettino finishes second, or if he can first. To answer your question directly,
is there a shift? Yes, there's a temporary shift, but only as long, in my book, as Mauricio Pochettino's there. Then it depends on who they replace him with. Because he won't stay at Tottenham, or I don't think he'll stay at Tottenham for years and years and years.
But going back to what Stan said in terms of that little shift of dimension. I mean, how long did it take Liverpool to establish themselves back in the 70s and 80s? How long did it take United to establish themselves in the 90s and 2000? You're just saying, OK, fine, they've had a few bad seasons and we just have to, you know?
What's these few bad seasons? They won the Cup last year. They qualified for the Champions League. If that's a bad season, good. Give me that.
No, they're not challenging for titles, Des. That's what we're trying to say. When's the last day Arsenal going to the last day still having a hope of winning a title? When is the last time they actually thought that the first place is a title, that's the first place carrying a cup, then the fourth place, which is not a cup, is a Champions League.
As Pep Guardiola is finding out, and Jose Mourinho,
you're standing right now,
Des,
like Stan Kroenke, and you're standing like Gazidis at the moment.
Ooh,
because it's financial reasons. You're saying
give me
Champions
money
League.
And I'm fine with
yeah,
that.
Exactly. Exactly. That's all you're saying.
It's not all about money, Des.
You're telling me?
It's just that I just sense the style and the way Wenger has gone about his job over the past. Certainly 12 months. We've got to give him that. He's lost a plot in lots of ways. He's now changing his formation to three at the back.
Which suits his players.
Well, he didn't know that only till
Neither did Conte until he got beat by Arsenal.
There's only six games left. Conte recognised that with three games. Conte recognised that three games into the season, not with six games left.
But it was a defeat that prompted it. It was a bad run.
Conte's changed
a bad run of 36 games.
This is after a guy who's been beaten by Bayern Munich, two legs, five, and then he realises he needs to play three at the back.
I've always argued here, if the players have so much say on this. Jack has let him down, Mustafi to a certain extent has let him down, Ozil has let him down, Sanchez's latest indiscretion has let him down.
Does he do? He get rid of the players?
Just
get rid of Sanchez and Ozil and Mustafi.
If Sanchez isn't playing for him, then yes.
Well, he can't just do that.
If Ozil's... nobody's chasing Ozil. This is the problem. Everyone's saying Ozil's a world-class player and nobody's chasing him.
The manager decides how well the players play in these days. Because Conte allowed the players to go with their formation last season, see what's the problem, and then he changed it, and then he squeezed players like Alonso, and you're talking about Matic, you're talking about Luis, and the manager...
£50 million and a £30 million player.
Has he been successful before this in most of his
Matic
transfers?
Has been. He's won titles in Portugal, in Benfica. Luis has really been successful.
You think...
Of course he has.
Coming back, you thought he's going to be as successful as he is now?
He's part of a splendid team that's hardly had an injury all season.
He's been having the best year of his career.
Yeah.
That's the point. Conte knew exactly where and what formation to play.
He started with four at the back. Conte started with four at the back.
But Luis wasn't there when he started with four at the back. He was after Luis so he could play the three at the back.
Yeah.
So when he finally got Luis in...
This is very rare, by the way. They're both agreeing, which is something...
Because we want to put Gang up on theirs.
That's good. OK, gentlemen, who will finish above who? Tottenham and Arsenal. Forget Chelsea.
For me, City to finish third, United to finish fourth.
My question.
The question is Tottenham or Arsenal?
Tottenham and Arsenal.
Of course Spurs are going to finish above Arsenal.
OK.
It's a no-brainer.
OK.
This season, Tottenham, but it's a short-term shift.
Okay.
It's a short-term shift.
Celebrity predictions for this game. Dez, are you going to go between Tottenham and Arsenal?
A draw?
I knew that before I even looked at the thing. I just knew you. Anyway, I'm going to go Tottenham 3-1.
Oh, OK.
I'm going for Spurs 3-2.
OK, celebrity predictions. Adam Carruthers is going 2-1. He should keep an eye on him because Adam's chasing him. Stanley Bernard is... just beaten me by one point. I hate you, by the way. Steve is 3-1. Marco D is going 1-1. Swana is 3-1. And Lizanne is 1-1. All right, time to have a look at some goals, just to refresh your memory on what this whole North London derby is all about. Some really memorable goals. If you're an Arsenal fan, how about Dennis Bergkamp? Do you remember his name? Do you remember this goal, Des?
Yeah, very, very nice. Lovely finish into the corner. Walker's the goalie, isn't it?
Yep. He was a pundit here, by the way, once, many moons ago.
Yeah, he was.
How about this free kick? But you have an issue with the goalkeeper, Des?
Yeah, look at David Seaman. He can't see the ball. Make sure you see the ball. He takes a look to his right, then he goes to his left.
Yeah, but I think he was... Even if he was on site with the ball, I don't think he would have got it. Because the power behind that ball was just absolutely brilliant.
How about this? Emmanuel Adebayor.
Probably the best at the moment. It was so hard that you take it first touch, and then to keep the ball with that much of power to keep it underneath the crossbar, that's just brilliant.
This is the best.
Oh, yeah. Kaboom!
Shades of Stanley Bernard during his playing days.
Actually, it's not. That was his first goal for Tottenham, so it's not the best. The next one we see is the best.
Is that your call, Steve? The next one from Harry Kane?
Absolutely. Look at the angle. Look at the pace. Look, he's got no right to put that. Top-quality goalkeeper.
It was the comeback game as well.
Yeah. Look at this angle. Yeah. I mean, it's a magnificent. Well,
it's something that we have seen from Henry years and years when he used to do that from that angle.
That for me is the best.
If you don't agree with our countdown, log on to our Twitter account. That's at Stadium Astro. We've heard from Arsene Wenger a bit earlier on. Time to hear from Mauricio Pochettino.
No, for us it's important to try. To be ready now and to prepare ourselves to try to play in the best way. We know what means the derby. I think all that means for our fans too. Maybe the last derby on Weyhard Lane. And only we need to think in try to win, to be the best, and try to get a 3 points to still fight for the title.
Just a quick one on Mauricio Pochettino in terms of what he's done at Tottenham. That, you know, if you put him at the likes of Jurgen Klopp, even Pep or Jose, what has he done right compared to the others for you?
Well, he's won nothing yet, has he? So he's done a lot right, but he's got to finish the job off.
Yeah.
And finishing the job off means he's got to stay, win a trophy. I mean, he's had a disaster at the Champions League, so he's got to prove himself at that level as well, whether it was Wembley Stadium that hampered them. But he still has a job to do. Relatively new into management, remember.
Mm.
It's a building process, but it can go wrong very quickly. You've seen them got knocked off at the semi-final. If they don't, and all of a sudden Arsenal have a little bit of a run and overtake Tottenham, then is it a bad season for Tottenham if they don't finish above Arsenal and finish fourth in the league? Yes, it is, sadly. It shouldn't be, but it would go down as a bad season for Tottenham and Pochettino if Arsenal finish above them.
Firstly, I think he understands his players. I mean, we talk about Conte when he bought Luis. Ideally, we thought he knew exactly what formation he was going to play. I think he's taken a step further this season in comparison to the Spurs we saw last season. We see more players playing with a smile because they understand. I think Wanyama, and that two in that middle, with Wanyama playing in that role, he's been flourishing. That just allows everyone ahead of him. As much as we talk about the Alis and your Canes and your Son Heung-min, it is about the boys at the back because he demands a lot off the ball. That's what Pochettino does. If you put a stat into it, they've run the most this season in the Premier League. And that's a manager that knows exactly what he wants from his side. And he's put the right youth in there to demand that level. So I think that's a manager moving forward in football evolution. I think he's an outstanding manager.
A breath of fresh air?
I think he's been terrific, but he is a young coach, and I don't think he's destined for Tottenham for a long time. So I don't think there's a dynasty going to be built at Tottenham.
I think there's a question this year that everyone's putting him up there as the manager of the year, or is going to be, is he the best coach in the Premier League at the moment?
He's probably the most improving coach, even though what he did at Southampton and Tottenham last year, I still think his team is developing beautifully. It's great to watch them. 8 wins on the spin is terrific. And they were very unlucky against Chelsea last week.
Well, who was the best coach at the moment?
He's probably up there.
No, Conte.
You're going to say Conte, of course you are. But he's probably up there. He's up there.
Yeah, and I think you're right. The most, I mean,
improved.
And he's getting better. And he's growing. He's grown, as I said before.
Yeah.
He can only get better and better and better. He can then get quality players in, which we've spoken about, because if Champions League football...
If he stays.
Yeah, I think he's going to stay. I think he looks a loyal guy. I know he had to move from Southampton because there's no loyalty in football. That's why I got the look off Desi. And don't take your coat off.
Oh, he will take his coat off a bit later on.
Don't take your
coat
off.
He's going to take his coat off later on. If you want him to take his coat off a bit later on, tweet us yes or no. We'll have a break, and when we return, we will have a look at Malaysian football in terms of whether the TMJ, the man himself, can be biased. That's next.
Costa. Hazard. Pedro Costa! It's lovely! It's lovely, lovely, lovely! That is the goal of would-be champions. And Rooney clears. And Martial's got clear of Barton, and now Burnley are horribly stretched. United have 4-on-2 here. And it's whipped in here towards Anthony Martial, who scores. That is counter-attack and some.
Brilliant.
Eriksen.
Despairing dive of a goalkeeper. Klukas can hit him. And he's hit it beautifully!
Ayew. Tom Carroll. That's deflected, and it's been deflected in!
Stay strong, bro. Stay strong.
Wonder Extra Presso, brewed from premium Arabica coffee beans for a stronger coffee taste.
Wonder Coffee.
Aksi bowling terhebat negara.
semakin sengit, semakin membara. Saksikan kejohanan bowling kebangsaan 2017 secara langsung di Astro Arena dan HD.
Welcome back. It's been fantastic if you're a Malaysian fan with regards to the national team and the national setup. But it gets a bit dicey when you come down to club football. There's been something going on, or something might not be going on. I've got Dez, Stan and Steve with me in the studio. He's giving me the dirty eye. There was a recent game between Pahang and JDT. Some feisty scenes took place. Fights broke out. Someone got kicked. Someone got kicked. But the thing is how FAM, the footballing governing body of the Malaysian football, handled the situation. Now, the player in question is Nazmi Faiz. I'll get to him in a bit. But after the match, these were the comments from the FAM with regards to what happened. Players involved in a scuffle, the players were named, and this was their first comment with the match report in terms of the discipline. Fans did not take it well because they were asking for Nazmi Faiz, who was the person who was guilty. The FAM slammed the fans on social media, as any adult would, to try and keep the situation quiet. They came out with another statement on the same day to explain who attacked who. And then a day later, they retract everything and go back to what the fans say, with, you know, Nazmi Faiz being the actual guilty party. I know Des didn't agree with our take on the whole situation, but Stan, you've got to put something on this. It's a joke, the way it was handled.
I think it's just work in progress. I would sit on a side that say that if you made a mistake, you should carry up your hand and say that you got to make it right. I think that's what has happened 24 hours. Yes, we are a bit judgmental. I would say if it was the old FAM, we would be saying, oh, here we go again. So, you know, with them not being strong enough on situations like this and the dilly-dally that happens over the past 30 years. But I still would say if it's a wrong has been done and then because of the reaction of what happened after they announced the first suspension or whatever they said about the Nazmi Faiz going off with a very hard warning.
Yeah.
And then 24 hours later, they're changing it and saying, you know what, he's going to get suspended and he got a fine. I just think they corrected the mistake that they made in the first case. That's about it.
Steve, let's have a look at the footage, the incident itself. There's a clear...
There's two elements. That's the first element.
Okay.
There's a kick up by Afik.
Yeah.
That's number one.
All right.
It's there. That Nazmi, the 21 yeah, coming yeah. in.
It's with a chip with shot.
Yeah.
That's the one.
So that's the one he originally got away with.
Yep.
And then that was subsequently corrected because he's guilty of sin.
Yes. Okay. Well, first of all, how did you get away with it?
That's
on the day, you can get away with it because the referee hasn't seen it. In retrospect, you can't get away with that because we've just seen what everybody else has seen,
they've
looking at it.
They've completely scuffed it on the first day. Yeah, they've missed it.
They missed it on
it's
the first
huge mistake.
One.
On the
first
mistake.
Day, but the second, when you've seen it, they still haven't suspended.
No, they still haven't suspended. But this is where I'm with Stan here. The right decision was made in the end. And that's the important thing. Yes, they could and should have got it right
quickly rectified.
But somebody has had a word with the disciplinary committee. I don't know who, but something has said, we say, that was a wrong decision. So at the end of it all, the correct decision has been made. And for me, a Malaysian football and writing on social media, that's fabulous to me. Why are you criticising that of all things?
You're having a right to have a say.
No, you're criticising TMJ for getting
no, not
for writing
I'm
back.
No, not TMJ. Criticising FAM. Who are they to attack the fans?
Of course,
they have the right facts. Correct.
You're one of the people who lives on social media. It's the modern way of managing things. And so you're saying, oh, I can do it. The fans can do it, but the FAM can't do it. Of course they can.
The positive. There's two things positive
fabulous.
Here, right? Firstly, after the first whatever decisions they made. The first decision was made. The reaction was crazy over social media, which means the fans are being heard.
Correct. Absolutely.
That is the biggest positive right
Absolutely.
Now. Do you agree with that?
Which I is agree.
The fact. Yeah, because now you're saying the fans have a voice. And the first thing TMJ said, football is for the people. Hmm. And the people has made their noise after that bad decision on the first weekend. In 24 hours, they've made sure they rectify the problem. Let's have a look again. What's the problem? What did we do wrong in the first decision?
But two reports
What did they do wrong in the first? When you've seen it,
they've missed it.
They've missed it.
No, at real time, they've missed it.
Yeah, no, and they've even in the subsequently, they've
How
missed
can
it.
He miss that? We've just seen what they've
I agree,
seen.
I agree. But they've missed it. That's why they came up with it.
How can he miss that? Were you sleeping when you were watching the video? How can he miss that?
that this is why we're both Stan and I are talking.
Can we watch it again?
This is why Stan and I are talking about this progress, because clearly the wrong decision was made.
Because I agree with you. Someone powerful
has come down and said that's the right. That's now we've got to correct that.
You have to act on this one. You see him now coming in here.
Yeah.
Now we're watching it split second.
And that's what are you doing, kiddo? What are you doing?
And this is not the first time this boy has been in trouble.
How can you not see that?
Yeah.
First time round.
And the other positive is, let's go back to TMJ. For many years, when he was asked to be the president, he said one of the biggest reasons
coat
he wouldn't
off.
Be...
I've just noticed his coat coming
he
off.
He wouldn't be the president of FAM because he would be biased towards Johor, yeah. right? And I think this is a huge step to show that no matter what colours you wear, you're going to be suspended. Because we've seen in the past, not saying names, but we've seen teams survive from relegation, let alone just suspension, but save themselves from relegation for odd reasons that I will never, ever understand until today. So, yeah.
So you're saying TMJ has made that decision?
Yeah. Well, I'm just saying.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, but it's under his hierarchy right now.
Okay.
Whether he's made it or not, he knows about it.
So he was involved
in it. And he's agreed in it.
Okay.
Of course, he's the president. Of course, he's seen into this. And it's his team who's playing.
Okay. So if you read between the lines, TMJ has made that decision.
Which is a good thing and a bad thing. It's good that he's been able to step in. It's bad, and it can't be retreated and that it wasn't dealt with correctly in the first
instance. And it shouldn't be repeated.
Correct.
Even it's the first time under his hierarchy, that's a mistake already. It shouldn't be repeated.
So do we agree that, okay, we're not confirmed, but we have a feeling that it was TMJ who stepped in as a leader, as the president of FAM, and said, sort this out immediately, regardless of how it's going to look, perceived by me?
If he has, that's brilliant.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's brilliant. That's about it.
So can he now finally be given an opportunity to represent himself as a neutral party? I understand, I remember his statement saying that I can't be the president because I might be biased, but for him to do this, and we're taking a massive leap, let's say he did come down hard on the authorities and said, correct him, suspend Nazmi. Do we finally have proof to say that this man is the man? He's going to call it right down the middle.
I think he will. I think this fellow's a passionate man. When he went into Johor, he was all about Johor. Now he's got to step out, and he is trying to step out. He's a football man. He gets it. He gets what's important. He gets that the players are important. He gets that getting things right is important. He gets that the fans are important.
Yeah. And he's reading social media, simply because, let's go back prior to this incident, what's happened. Firstly, when they appointed Tan Cheng Ho as the assistant coach of Malaysia, he was said that he's weakening Kedah. And he came on a response to it again. He said, I'm just picking the best local coach around for your national team.
And Tan Cheng Ho is the best
local
coach.
What happens with Kedah, with all these things going around, they get a red card, Rizal Ghazali, the right back, one of the best right backs in Malaysia right now, and the first choice for Malaysia, gets a red card, and they lose 5-0. And when's the last time Kedah actually lost 5-0? So basically, they were saying again, now he's done the job by weakening Kedah. And now, with the result, and Joe had a blatant penalty call right there in this game, which they should have got, and he didn't get it.
Correct.
And then with Nazmi's suspension. So I just think it's about football. It's nothing about anyone being biased. It's just how we judge on Premier League week in, week out. Referees make genuine mistakes. Everyone makes genuine mistakes, and FAM have made a genuine mistake.
And to be fair to him, to build it on again, they've called for video assistance for the referees. Personally, I don't agree with it because all the matches aren't televised at the top level. Until the matches are televised, then I don't see how you can have video assistance for one game and not for another. But the situations are being addressed. For years, I've heard people since I've been coming into this country, something's got to happen with Malaysian football. Something is happening, and it's darn good.
So he's the man.
Darn good. Darn good.
Darn good.
Yeah. I think absolutely he's making statements. And he's setting his stall out that you don't mess with the FAM.
And
he's not him, because he's taken it as the FAM and the governing body.
And to be honest, it's not been easy for him. Firstly, he announced the national coach.
Correct.
And a week later, we still don't have a national coach. And also with the referees, he's trying to make it as professional as he can because
he's making it easy for himself by making the right decisions rather than brushing things under the carpet, which has happened for far too long.
And
he's saying, it's out in the open, I'm going to address the situations
facing backlash because at times when you make a decision like that, brash, and then it backfires. But still, it's right. He's trying to address it and he will have ups and downs. He will have this turbulence, but he's addressing it.
And he'll address it on social media. So if you have a pop at him and you're wrong, he will come back at you.
Yeah.
And the FAM will come back at you. And I think that's great.
Yeah. And you, on social media, you can have a go back at him.
It's okay, never mind. He discontinued his Twitter account. It's okay. But we're moving in the right direction under him.
Big time.
Yeah, big time. And I just think there's a lot more to go. And I would say this again, we didn't sign, TMJ is the president, but we didn't sign him as a 30-goal scorer in international football. We still don't have a striker national team. So it will take time. The talent is the same pool, even though whether we're getting back the same talent from Johor.
That'll take a lot of time.
That is going to take a long time. So fans, even though I know fans are jumping, but the results are made on the pitch. They're not made outside the pitch. Of course, the transition that happens outside helps the team, but again, it's going to take a while before we see the national team actually getting results.
I can honestly say this, and I believe you'll agree with me. He is the first step in moving the right step forward. That's enough for me. All right, we'll take a break, and when we return, we'll be turning our attention to Joey Barton and match gambling or fixing, or however you want to term it, at home. But before that, here's a look at who will be making it to the finals of the WizKid on Football Countdown. That's next. All right, it is Group A again, Mutiara versus Help. In terms of what has been going on, this is just a competition to see who will be facing off in the finals on the final show of Wonder Football Countdown. Help, you'll be going first. Your team is, of course, Liverpool. You have 30 seconds. At the end of 30 seconds, there'll be a magical buzzer. Are you ready?
Yes.
Question number one, true or false? Daniel Sturridge has scored 4 goals so far this season, but is yet to score in the Premier League. True
false.
Or false? Sorry?
False.
Wrong. What is Liverpool's nickname?
Red.
Correct. Who is Liverpool's record signing?
Sadio Mane.
Close, but not Sigur. Wrong. When did Liverpool last win the League Cup? League Cup.
2012.
Correct. Liverpool legend Luis Suarez was signed from which club?
Ajax.
Correct. Which rival club plays in the Merseyside derby against Liverpool?
Liverpool.
Oh, I got to double check. Is that a yes or a no? Can we get that answer? It was right on the buzzer. I am so sorry. I tried to speed up as fast as I could. I couldn't. 3 points nevertheless. Mutiara, same rules apply. You have chosen both Arsenal and Manchester United. Abdullah, Ian, are you ready?
Yes.
All right, 30 seconds, same rules apply. Everybody relax. Everybody calm down.
Relax.
Your time starts now. Who was Arsenal's manager before Arsene Wenger?
Pat Rice.
Wrong. Which Manchester United player kung fu kicked a Crystal Palace fan in
Eric
January?
Eric Cantona.
Correct. Who is Arsenal's top scorer in the Premier League history of the North London derbies?
Thierry Henry.
No. What is the name of Manchester United's home ground?
Old Trafford.
Correct. Who wears the number 13, the jersey, for Arsenal?
David Ospina.
Correct. United's record goal scorer in a single Premier League season is? Ooh, we have a dead heat, 3 apiece. Now, 5 questions. Which team has conceded the most amount of goals in a single Premier League season? Ooh. Quickly, my friend, quickly.
Okay.
Anything would do right now.
Aston Villa.
Close, but wrong. Right. Who has conceded the most amount of goals in a Premier League game in terms of the history? Who has conceded the most goals in Premier League history in terms of a team conceding the most amount of goals?
Blackburn Rovers.
Wrong.
Middlesbrough.
Wrong. Okay, question goes to you, gentlemen. So now it's still dead apiece, 3-3, right? Which team has the most amount of points in a season without winning the league? Which means they lost on goal difference.
Manchester United.
Wow, well done. Congratulations, coming from a Liverpool fan, no wonder he knows. Ooh. That. All right, 2 more questions, you can still salvage a point, all right? Which team scored the fewest points in a season and survived relegation? Which team scored the fewest points in a season and survived relegation?
QPR?
Wrong.
Sunderland.
Wrong. Final question, gentlemen. Okay, it goes to you, but there's a limited amount of time, you can't take forever. Fair enough? One player has got 11 consecutive goals in a Premier League. Who is he?
Jamie Vardy.
Gentlemen, I apologise. It is 5-3. So it's 2 wins for Help so far in Group A. But it's not over. It's not over yet so far. You have 1 more game, or rather 2 more games to salvage pride, all right? That's it.
My boyfriend.
Hello, uncle.
Stay strong, Phil. Stay strong.
Wonder Extra Presso, brewed from premium Arabica coffee beans for a stronger coffee taste.
Wonder Coffee.
The FIFA Beach Soccer World Cup 2017 on Astro Supersport and Astro Go.
Watch the Premier League live and exclusive on Astro.
I will forever be grateful for it. This has been a bucket list item for me to achieve in life. With a lot of passion, a lot of energy, a lot of effort, it came true.
We put the good in the good in the good life.
The good life.
We put the good in the good in the good life.
I said the good life.
We put the bad in the past, now we alright.
We alright. Hey, hey,
hey, hey. You gotta love that show, Wishlist. Yeah,
wow. Any sporting event, if you would like to go catch it, we can make your wish and dream come true. Get in touch with us. Just to recap what happened in the last segment with regards to TMJ and FAM, my comment was about FAM, how they dealt with the situation. I did not attack TMJ like Des Corkhill said so. I want to live to see my daughter grow up and, you know, attend
just
college.
Move on.
What are you trying to say, bro? We know what I'm trying to say. Phil Neville was on Twitter. Thank you, Des. You might as well pull the knife out of the back. Yeah, but Phil Neville was on Twitter recently and he came up with his dream team for next season in terms of...
Gary Neville,
Phil Neville.
Was it?
Phil.
Okay.
Phil.
All right, just
Phil.
Checking, just checking.
Okay, move away.
The Chuckle Brothers.
The Chuckle Brothers, but they came up with their dream team for next season, yes. Just picking individual teams and coming with the players they would like to see in the club. So we have asked you,
okay,
gentlemen, to pick teams. Stan, you'll be going first. Who is your dream team for next season and the players that'll be in it?
For Manchester United.
For Manchester United, I've gone, it's called a dream team, so it's unrealistic. So anyways, it's
what's
dream.
What do you mean it's unrealistic? Just go with it.
It's called a dream.
Fantasy football.
They are by Wanda Chilini. I'm playing with a back three. And in front of them will be Valencia down the right-hand side as a wing-back. Got Jordi Alba on the left. Kante, cheers in front
Mane's
of that back three.
Mane's never
going to
move.
Mane, Pogba, Hazard. And I would love to see Rashford develop as a top striker.
Chiellini, at his age, you want him to move to United.
He needs to give some inspiration to a few of those.
I was asked to do this, I thought it was a bit. He had to be a little bit serious. If it was a dream team.
Well, it's mentioned a dream team.
Okay. If it's a dream team, that is a waste of time. Because where's Messi? Where's Messi and Ronaldo in this dream team? If it's a dream team.
Don't want them.
You don't want them in that team?
I don't want them in that team.
Okay.
That's why they're not there.
This is where you are messing about.
I'm keeping them in a Spanish
league.
This
is where you are messing about.
The best league
in the
world.
Because that's neither here nor there.
Okay.
It's not a dream team, it's your team that you'd like.
Steve, your dream team.
My team is here, okay? Joe Hart. I'm just looking at the placements that Liverpool need.
But realistic, in terms of who they can buy.
Yeah, maybe the one that's probably out of their league is Griezmann. And you'd replace Griezmann with Isco. That's the one I'd be looking for. So I'm looking at positions where Liverpool need. And it's simple. Goalkeeper, Joe Hart's there, he's available, he's a decent keeper. Centre-half, Van Dijk is one of the best and he's proven. He's only going to get better, he's big and strong, he's going to get fitter and stronger. Matip I would keep, I think he's done very well.
Yeah.
The midfielder needs somebody to... I know Lallana's done very, very well. Henderson, they'll need him for his energy. You look at Mane, he's probably... I mean, give him another season, he's going to be sensational. Mbappe, if they can push the bar out and say, this is our marquee signing, go for him. Absolutely 100%. Then you've got Firmino, who can't even get in that team. You could even put Coutinho as the number 10, put Firmino on the left-hand side. So I'm actually being realistic. I'm not playing fantasy football. I'm actually trying to put a team there and be half sensible. Over to you, Des.
Well, I took it quite seriously as well, Stan.
I thought they sell
Lukaku and they sell Barkley, so there's a lot of money in the bank.
Okay.
And there's money coming in from the Iranian owners. So this is me, Joe Hart again, solid goalkeeper. You've got Maguire from Hull, who's doing the business. Otamendi could be surplus to requirements of Man City. You put them along with Ashley Williams, who I like, Paul Parker, as a three at the back. Midfield, they're already there. Coleman, if he's fit. If he's not fit, then Bezic can come in. Gay and Schneiderlin, terrific.
Holgate is there.
Holgate as well, and Baines. So the midfield four is the same. It's up front, though. Marco Reus might be available. What a good little signing that would be. Rooney Or the one on the other side, Bolasie has been injured all season. Terrific talent.
Niasse could come back. Niasse's still on loan. He's done fantastically well at Hull.
But up front, either Rooney or the other option, and the one I can't believe nobody's talking about, Mauro Icardi.
Yeah.
He's scoring a goal every other game in Italy for the last three or four seasons.
You think Ruiz will end up
he's
Everton?
He's captain at Everton. Are going to become one of the. There's going to be a big
what
seven.
What are the chances of them having Marco Ruiz at their club next season?
This is you've talked fantasy.
Yeah,
I'm talking.
Realistic.
I'm talking.
You said realistic. So
Marco Ruiz will
at
be
Everton.
Available.
And that's realistic.
They are going to be one of the big clubs in the next two or three seasons.
Not next season, though. You're not going to see Marco Ruiz at Everton
Give
if you're realistic.
Seasons. Give us two seasons.
I think Maguire and Otamendi.
No.
And you've got Williams there as well.
Yeah.
That's a dodgy defence.
Dodgy defence.
Dodgy.
I like that. I think you've got three solid
Otamendi
defenders.
Is being,
I think you put Williams, him in a straight Otamendi. Man-marking job and a one-on-one. Perfect.
Well, not you've played him in a three.
At a three?
You've got to be a... Well,
yeah.
You've got to be able to be...
So, Ashley, Williams can sweep?
There's no team in the Premier League can play the three properly. It's only Tottenham who've got a playmaker in Dyer and Luiz is a playmaker in Chelsea.
What
there's
do you
no
guys think?
There.
What do you guys think? Get on Twitter. Whose team will be the best team, in your opinion? Is it Stan's, Steve's, or Des Corkhill? And you're not surprising that nobody had Joey Barton in their starting 11 for next season. Easy segue into our next...
Segue with that.
I mean, let's talk about Joey Barton. He's not exactly Mr. Squeaky Clean on the pitch, off the pitch. Now he's been banned from the lovely game of football for 18 months due to his involvement in gambling. Gambling is illegal here in Malaysia, haram. But why would you do it, Des? For the amount of money he makes, why would you do it?
I don't know. I'm not a gambler myself. The odd flutter on the Grand National when I was back in the UK when you could, but I don't get it, particularly at that level. Okay, have a gamble, but not on football. Not if you're at the top level. Not if you're earning really good money. Not if you've had the education which players have had at clubs. And he's been at big clubs. He will have had the warning signs. You don't gamble.
Yeah.
And his argument is not that he gambled and that he was caught, but that it's too harsh a ban because others haven't had it. I'm kind of looking at it and rather like we said with Malaysian football before, I think that is the right decision because it sends out a really strong message. But football, Premier League football, needs to send out a bigger message by not having the 365s on the shirt sleeves and on the front.
See, the thing is, he's a rich young man, so he doesn't have to gamble to make money.
Correct.
So he's gambling because it's an addiction. He's made that plain. He's come out and said, it's an addiction. I just love gambling since whenever we've been available to gamble with monies. And the quotes, and this is from the FA, is betting not calculated to make money and not trying to fix matches. So it's not calculated. So he's not trying to make a hell of a lot of money out of.
Yeah, and he's come open to show his.
Which
his
they've already said wages. The FA. Yeah. They've said it's not about match fixing. Fine. What is it about?
It's about integrity in football. Because if you're gambling on football, a match that you are involved in, there's a realistic chance. That match.
He never played in any of the games that he. That
but he might have inside information. He might have the old first ball being put over.
Well,
over,
that's
over
changed as well.
Line.
The rules have changed.
But you know what I mean. Mm. Just don't. Like, I'm not saying don't gamble on horses.
Okay.
Not saying don't gamble on other stuff.
Well,
don't gamble
as well. I would say to anyone watching this, don't gamble. Full
indeed,
stop.
Indeed.
Yeah, full stop.
Indeed.
But we're talking about then the sponsors.
Yeah, I think that's.
You see it around the ground during the game.
Yeah.
Next goal scorer, bet £10, get a free bet.
The biggest problem
encouraging
is that's what he came out and said. He said, as long as clubs are being the ambassadors of the betting companies, then...
Tottenham, a few seasons ago with their jersey.
You get your West Ham's and you get your
casino,
Spurs.
I think
your
it was.
Spurs mentioned.
Mansion. Mansion, yeah.
So you get them being the advocates because they are the biggest league in the world in terms of marketing. And they are showing off their
how does this warrant an 18-month ban?
Because
this is the least. They say it's the least he could give him. It's not. 6 months is the least he could give him.
Because it's not. It's his first offence of this kind. It's certainly not his first offence. B, you say he says he's got an addiction. He only says he's got an addiction once he's been caught. C, it's such an important message to push out. Gambling should not be anywhere near football. The
because it's Joey Barton.
I think.
Listen,
clubs,
it's so convenient.
It's not.
It's an
listen,
important
does,
message to send
he,
out.
He also brings the trouble on himself. Does Joey? He's from my neck of the woods.
He spent over £205,000 over a period of time. he then got back £188,000.
So he's a bad gambler.
Well, he's lost £16,000 over a 10-year, a 12-year period. Now, as a bad gambler,
but Steve, this is the wrong argument. As a player, and as a manager, I know that you will have given out the message, or your clubs have given out the message.
I don't condone this by any means.
But it's also against written rules.
The punishment is harsh.
Yeah, but that's not the point, isn't it? Whether he's a good gambler or a bad gambler.
Correct.
It doesn't
matter.
What he's saying. The point is, I think right now, the clubs have to come on and say, even though if we are being sponsored by a betting company, you guys are not allowed to bet on football.
The point I was making, that he's good or bad gambler, is that he's an addict. He's hooked on it.
So do it on horse races. Yes. Do it on something else. Don't do it on the sport that you're involved in, which is completely against the rules.
He doesn't just do it on football.
He signed a contract, and that contract will say anything that brings the game into disrepute, such as gambling.
Well, there's other stuff that we can bring in. Leon Osman was a gambler.
Yeah. OK, let's have a look at the comments from Osman as well as another player as well. Osman, with his comments, he said, within 6 weeks of me placing bets, the betting company blocked my account. I had to phone them up, explain I'm no longer playing football or associated with Everton Football Club. I'm just taking a certain part of it. They looked at my account, released it once they realised I had nothing to do with football. There's another, of course, a player who came out and said that he had problems with gambling, Matthew Errington. At one point in time, £1.5 million in debt.
And Keith Gillespie as well.
Keith Gillespie. Yeah. But what Matthew said was, during his playing days, these betting companies came into the club at youth level and contacted these players and said, you know what, you can put in a bet, it's nothing wrong. Shouldn't the club and shouldn't these companies take responsibility?
It does go back, I mean, in relation to what you're asking, it goes back to the era where tobacco companies were sponsoring football.
Absolutely.
It goes back to the alcohol companies that were sponsoring football. They've gone out the window now. That's the reason why, because it's not good to footballers. So now, it's the responsibility of the clubs to not associate themselves with betting companies, and the moment they can't do so because the money is so big in there.
So why can't these people be blamed, the real ones? Okay, Joey Button, I mean, we're not defending what he did, fair enough, but he's being made the scapegoat.
Yeah, absolutely. It's harsh, the punishment. He's 34, you know? He's missed an opportunity. Okay, that is the end of his career. No two ways about it. Why? I'm not saying there's a right time or a wrong time. There's four games left of the season. Why can't they do it at the end of the season and say, you're banned for 18 months? At the end of the season, at least let them go out on a bit of a high with Burnley and say, right, that's the end, 18-month ban.
Yeah.
Why with four games to go? It's nonsensical.
It just sounds like you're standing up for him here, and I don't really see
if
how
you listen to my words, you can't condone what he's
done. But then you're saying,
let's
run it through for the next four games.
Yeah, I'm saying it's a bit harsh the way they've slammed him now. And the punishment of 18 months when his career's over, because 18 months is well past his sell-by date anyway, Burnley have come out and said he's no longer got a contract, if that's the case, which I think they would have given him another 12 months.
Sean Dyche has all came out and said it's a bit too harsh.
I agree, it's too harsh.
But there's one thing that this sends out. It's a message.
Absolutely.
So every kid out there, as much as you're saying it's harsh, every kid out there would say that now we just can't bet on football anymore. We've just got to stop.
And the next thing is the FA and the Premier League have then got to distance themselves from these clubs.
The clubs. The clubs have a huge responsibility. As much as
Already do. Correct me if I'm wrong, but you at Swindon, the players sign a contract and they say anything. There's something about gambling in there, isn't there, when the players sign contracts and the clubs get people in to talk about gambling and the dangers therein.
Well, I've never seen it.
Okay, just to
get You've never seen it.
No, not
all right,
a gambling
gentlemen,
thing.
Just a quick one with regards to the FA and the betting rules. The FA's betting rule applies to the top eight tiers of English football. Players, managers, club employees, and match officials are prohibited from betting on any football matter worldwide. And another one is bets on results, goal scorers, in-game play, player transfers, manager changes, or even promotion and relegations are banned. You can join us on our Facebook page and we will talk about this a bit later on in added time. As for now, we'll take a break and when return, we'll be answering your questions and we'll be getting their predictions for the weekend games. That's coming up next.
The sun shines bright in Las Colinas Country Club, with an annual gathering for the greater good. Here, the focus is not on winning alone, but in getting people back on their feet.
Fabulous week for Jenny Shin.
And there's no better reason to celebrate in that. The Volunteers of America Texas Shootout on Golf Channel.
The Sultan Aslan Shah Cup 2017, live on Astro Arena and HD.
We're nearly at the end of the show. That really went fast. Time for quick fire, the questions you've sent in. The first question is Sanchez's acting worthy of an Academy Award? Watch this, gentlemen. Is it truly DiCaprio at his best, Des?
No, it's worthy of a ban. It's worthy of a
ban. It is a ban.
I wouldn't disagree.
It's cheating.
I wouldn't disagree. Did the referee book him?
It's cheating.
It's cheating. We will get to that later. Next question. Will Chelsea finally keep a clean sheet this weekend?
Well, it's difficult. I think they might do, yes. There's no reason why they won't.
No, they won't.
I predicted they'll lose at Everton, so no.
Will De Gea be at Manchester United next season?
No, I think he's already signed the contract, hasn't he, for Real Madrid?
Oh, we'll see with black and white later on. Yes or no?
I think he will.
I don't think he will be, no.
Steven Gerrard, is he a future Liverpool manager?
Absolutely.
Quickly, we've got 33 seconds.
Possibly.
Doubtful. It's such a tough business.
Okay, based on their first season, is Pellegrini better than Pep? Remember, he won the league and the League Cup in his first year, Pellegrini at Manchester City. So is he better than Pep?
No.
No?
No.
Based on the first season?
So that's like comparing Apple...
yes or no? Quick one, Des. Quick
no.
One. No.
No, he's not. No.
No, he's not.
So winning titles in your first season doesn't make you a better manager after the first season?
That's an obscure question.
The people who came up with the question are the fans. They have a say on social media.
But we can also have a pop back at them as well. I think it's an obtuse question.
All right, up to Chris too, and whatever it is. All right, we got some questions as well. One is from Junior. He says, should Chelsea start Fabregas ahead of Pedro against Everton this weekend? Do you agree?
No reason to. No reason to. I think Pedro should start.
Different positions, why would he?
Yeah. Yeah, why?
Never mind, all right.
Why change it? I don't
Raish,
even
who's asking
questions.
These questions?
The first one is Tony Jr. Second Tony, one is Raish. Do you Tony. Think that Hazard needs to be a little more selfish on the pitch? Have you not been watching him play?
No, again.
No.
No.
Okay, it's a unanimous no. Come on, Raish, what is wrong with you, my friend? Satish with the next question. Was Fellaini's red card a fair decision?
Now, this one's got me really angry, because I say...
When are you not angry?
Aguero has played for this, and everyone's going to say, oh, Aguero was clever. Aguero cheated, because he dived firstly. He's then been aggressive going into Fellaini, and then he's reacted like a pop star.
What's a pop star? Then?
Falling over when
like
when
Sanchez,
there's,
like
he's
Sanchez,
been the aggressor. He's been the aggressor. And Fellaini's kind of put his head
you're
in.
A right
it's not
a tree.
It's not
absolutely
a the Aguero a thing does my head.
Absolutely yeah. Nonsense. You've got how tall is Fellaini? 6 foot four. How tall is Aguero?
Aguero's the one who moves to him.
It doesn't matter.
He's the one who's made the aggressive move.
If you walk to someone and you're head to head, fine. Aguero's walking to Fellaini, he hits him in the chest.
Would you have gone down?
Fellaini...
Would you have gone down, honestly?
That's the difference. We're talking about this incident, OK? He's 6 foot four, Aguero's
he's made the effort
five
to
foot
go
nine.
Down.
His head goes there to there. So he goes down, he hits movement.
And you wouldn't have gone down, I know.
No,
you
I wouldn't
have
gone
down.
But that's not the point.
Yes, it is
but
the
point.
But
no, it's not
but
the point. It's not the point.
Does he deserve a red card?
Yes, he does.
In the modern rules, yes. I'm saying the modern rules are kind of snowflake.
But he's hit, buttered... Aguero, I know what you're saying. I know what you're doing.
He's moved his head in. I tell you, a headbutt and that
he's
are
made,
two very different
he's made
things.
It's an intent,
yes.
And he's touched him.
And so has Aguero. Aguero's moved towards him. Aguero is
because
moving towards him.
People do when they're annoyed about something.
Yeah, so his reaction is, and Fellaini has stood his ground.
He didn't touch him.
Fellaini stood his ground.
Fellaini then lowered his head. If you lower your head,
it's not
it's an intent.
If I'm coming up to you, squaring up to you, you're going to throw a punch at me. And you stop. And
I
punch you.
If I do this to Stanley...
No, don't hit him for real.
If I punch you and you've intended to punch me, The thing is, it's no-brainer. I've punched you, but you tried
whether it's
so
hard,
it's wrong on my side, because I hit you.
Whether it's hard enough to force him to go down is a different issue.
I think he's provoked the incident, he's been the aggressor, and then he's over.
If he doesn't go down, the referee should send them off out as well anyway, so it doesn't really matter.
So, so yes or no, a quick summary.
A red card, yes.
What was the question?
All right,
it's a Man United player, just say yes.
Premier League games coming up this weekend. Sunday we'll have some few games that you'll really like to keep an eye on, but before that, as you can see, all the information is down there. The big one is the North London Derby, it's on Sunday. Before that, it's Everton, Chelsea and United will be in action on that. Just a quick predictions, something that might happen out of the blue for you?
Everton to beat Chelsea.
Oh, wow, really?
I think. Yeah. I keep thinking Chelsea are going to slip up, and they've got through games, but I don't know how. Against the Tottenham, they were the second best, then they scored these wonderful goals against Southampton.
Who's this?
Chelsea. I think they're going to slip.
Steve, you're
next. All season. No, we say the big game is Arsenal, Tottenham. The first one is Everton, Chelsea. Now, if Everton do turn Chelsea over, that becomes massive.
Yeah.
It really does.
Yeah.
But I can't see it. I can't see it.
No, it's on Astro, you can watch it.
I can't see it, I've got my glasses on. I just can't see Chelsea losing the league.
Okay.
They can still afford to get beat by Everton as well, you
so
know.
So, Everton.
Remember, and look at the run-in. It's far easier than anybody else.
Time, Steve. So, yes,
prediction, Steve.
Chelsea to win the league, end of story.
Oh, my God. Diego, don't change the topic. He's
Diego
not Everton.
Costa to get a red card in this match.
Chelsea to win a game.
So that's your prediction?
Yeah.
Costa to get a red card in this game?
Yes.
It's going to be red hot at Goodison.
It is going to be.
Blue hot.
And Everton to win, yes.
Good point.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for trying to get me fired on the first time you've been back on the show.
I think you've done that yourself.
I think I have as well. Thank you very much.
They were out of your words. Your words out of your mouth.
I didn't say that. All I said was the FAM can do better.
Oh, you still got it.
Thank you very much. Good night.
Rest.